everyone, and welcome to this week's edition of Quarantine. This week, we are going to be talking about hope and despair through the eyes of one of my favorite people in Scripture, the apostle to the apostles, Mary Magdalene. Tonight, you're going to need a Bible, you're going to need your family, so why don't you go ahead and grab those things and meet me back here in a minute. Welcome back, everyone. I hope you've got your Bible. I hope you've got your family. And let's begin the Life Night. This week's Life Night is called Firsthand. And we're going to be looking at hope and despair through the eyes of Mary Magdalene. Now, Mary Magdalene is one of the most misunderstood characters in Scripture. There are a lot of things that we think we know about her, which may not be true. There are some that we just might not know about her. But there are a few places in Scripture where we actually get a chance to meet Mary Magdalene and find out why she was so deeply connected to Jesus, why we see Pope Francis calling her the apostle to the apostles, and we see her being elevated to one of the highest positions of any of the women in the history of the church. She is an outstanding figure for any of us who are going through difficult times. And so to kind of learn a little bit about the background of Mary Magdalene, I want you to take out your Bibles and turn to the Gospel of Luke, chapter 8, verses 1 through 3. So Luke chapter 8, verses 1 through 3. Now, this is an extremely small passage, just a glimpse at Mary Magdalene, but there's actually quite a bit we can learn from it. So for our first discussion question tonight, what I want to talk to you about is just what this means about Mary Magdalene, what we learn from this very small piece of Scripture. So go ahead, flip to Luke chapter 8, verses 1 through 3. Pause the video, read this with your family, and kind of talk about what can we learn about Mary Magdalene from this very small glimpse into her life? Welcome back. Let's take a close look at this particular passage in Scripture and see kind of a few things that we can note from it. So this again is chapter 8 of Luke, verses 1 through 3. Afterward, he journeyed from one town and village to another, preaching and proclaiming the good news of the kingdom of God. Accompanying him were the 12, and some women who had been cured of evil spirits and infirmities: Mary, called Magdalene, from whom 7 demons had gone out; Joanna, wife of Herod's steward Chuza; Susanna, and many others who provided for them out of their own resources. Now, there's two things that I kind of want to talk about. First of all, what we learn about Mary Magdalene is that 7 demons were cast out of her, right? That's really the only piece of this that is explicitly about Mary Magdalene in this particular verse, is that Mary had 7 demons cast out of her. Now, we know that casting demons out of people is not something that's unusual in the Gospels. We see this as one of the things that Jesus does. It's one of the ways that he shows as God that he has power over the body and the spirit, is to cast out these demons. But there's something very important about the number of demons that were cast out of Mary Magdalene. See, in the Gospels, in Scripture in general, numbers have very important meanings. And 7 is a number of spiritual completion or fulfillment. There's something beyond just the number of 7 that is insinuated here when we see that 7 demons were cast out of Mary Magdalene. In fact, what we're seeing is that Mary Magdalene was somebody who was so consumed by these demons, so consumed by her sin, that was it. She was this completion of 7 demons. She was completely consumed by evil. And when we think of somebody like that, we think of somebody who we might just want to write off. We might want to say, you know what? They're hopeless, right? There's nothing that can be done for that person. They've sealed their fate. They're completely consumed by evil. But Jesus sees Mary Magdalene and casts the 7 demons out of her, right? Which really, really tells us that this person who was completely consumed by sin is now completely consumed by the love of God, right? And we see Mary Magdalene being somebody who is chosen by Jesus in a number of these very special ways. She's incredibly close to him. We also read here in verse 3 that these women provided for the apostles out of their own resources. Now, women were not big earners at that time, right? We find ourselves now in a time where women are still struggling for equality, but back then, there were not a lot of resources that a woman on her own could have, right? And so these women, including Mary Magdalene, are giving of their very little that they have to support the teaching of the apostles. So she is putting her money where her mouth is. She's following Jesus. She's giving of her resources. And we see her rise to this very special place in the life of Jesus, where we see at the foot of the cross, we see Mary, our Blessed Mother. We see John, who was the apostle who Jesus loved. This is probably Jesus' closest best friend on earth, right? And we see Mary Magdalene, this woman who, whereas like Peter, who is inspired by the Holy Spirit and is going to become the first pope, right? Peter runs. Mary Magdalene, who was this person who the world had given up on, this person who was consumed by evil, consumed by sin, we see her standing boldly at the foot of the cross. And guess what else? We also see her as the first person in the gospel who Jesus appears to after he rises from the dead. Mary Magdalene is for us a symbol of hope, right? But her journey was extremely difficult. We read about her this Easter Sunday in the gospel. And what we read was that when Mary Magdalene walked toward the tomb, right? She's mourning the loss of Jesus. She's mourning the loss of somebody who saved her from complete destruction, who represents her hope, her future, her life, right? She's mourning the loss of this person. She's walking toward the tomb and she sees that the stone has been rolled away and the tomb is empty. And her first thought is despair. They've taken the Lord. And she runs to the other apostles to tell them. Peter and John run toward the tomb. John runs a little bit faster, right? But he still waits for Peter to get there, which is also interesting. And Mary Magdalene is weeping because she believes that the Lord has been taken, that he's gone. So somebody even in this position who faces this extreme level of loss in her life does have a difficult time holding on to hope. But that's really what we're called to do in these dark times. Now, normally, if I was teaching you this at a different moment in history, what I would ask you to do right now is to think of something, somebody who is very, very close to you, and imagine that they were gone all of a sudden, out of nowhere, unexpectedly, and to talk about how that felt. Right now, as we face together in this community, this COVID-19 pandemic, right, as we are in this place where all of these elements of our lives that we thought were going to be there for us, elements of our lives where we placed our identity, where we placed our hope for our future, are not really there right now, or they look really, really different. People who we thought were going to be near us are not near us right now. So what I kind of wanted to take a moment to do is, with you and your family who are present right now, just take a couple minutes to discuss what is the greatest, the most present thing that you feel like you've lost right now. What is the most present loss to you? And how has that impacted your view of the future? Again, what is the most present loss to you right now? And how has that impacted your view of the future? There is no question at this particular moment in our history that we have suffered great loss. We are probably still going to suffer great losses, and our future is uncertain at this moment in time. None of the experts can really tell us exactly what's going to happen. Just like in the gospel, although really in a more extreme way in the gospel, the apostles, many of whom just sort of left their families and their livelihoods to follow Jesus, they gave up everything to follow Jesus. Mary Magdalene, who experienced this amazing conversion of mind and heart, right, who chooses to follow Jesus, give of her resources, and devote her life to the ministry of our Lord. It's kind of important for us right now to take a look at Mary's response to that loss, right? So when Mary believes that Jesus is gone, not just dead, but that his body has been stolen and taken away, right? Can you imagine just for a minute what that must be like? Somebody who you care about really, really deeply, they die unexpectedly, and then you go to do honor to them, right? And you get to their graveside and you find out that somebody has robbed their grave, has taken their body. Who knows what they're going to do to it or what's happening with it, why it's gone. And of course, there's this period of intense mourning while you don't know what's happening. But what happens is this, is that Jesus appears to Mary Magdalene in the Gospel of John, right, in chapter 20. And she says to this man who she doesn't know who it is, but it's Jesus. And she says, "Sir, if you carried him away, tell me where you laid him and I will take him." And Jesus says to her, "Mary," he calls her by name, right? Jesus calls her. He says, "Mary." And she turns to him and she says, "Rabuni," which means teacher, right? So in this moment of desperation, Jesus calls out to Mary, and Mary responds. She recognizes him. She claims him for who he is, because you know what? She is a person of hope, even in this moment of darkness. And she recognizes our Lord when he calls out to her by name. Friends, God is going to call each of us by name in the middle of this crisis, in the middle of what is going on right now. Jesus is still here for us. That is our hope. That is the hope that we profess as the people of God. And so we need to find a way to make ourselves awake and aware of the ways that Jesus calls, because it's quiet. So what does that look like? Well, what it looks like is, let's take a look at the way our day is structured right now, right? I know we have a lot of schoolwork to do, and it's weird in this digital format. If you are a working parent right now, you've probably got a lot of work to do. If you're like me, you're spending a lot of time on Zoom meetings, which is not what I dreamed my career would look like. I don't know about you, but it's not glorious. So we're in this pattern, right? And I think a lot of us are starting to find a rhythm. We're starting to find a flow. The question is this: does that rhythm and flow numb us to what is going on, or does it make us more aware to what's around us? And here's the deal. Just like the loss of Jesus, just like the crucifixion of Jesus was incredibly painful to his followers, this crisis, this pandemic, is going to show us a lot of pain. We're going to see a lot of pain that people are experiencing. You're going to experience pain. The people in your family are going to experience pain. And it's really easy to like turn on Netflix, turn on something, you know, whatever it is. Maybe you have like games on your phone that you really like, or you're just posting pictures of like the side of your head to Snapchat or something. Whatever we're doing, we kind of try to numb ourselves to that pain. But in those moments of pain, in those moments of our darkest despair, just like Mary weeping by the tomb, right? In those moments, Jesus is going to call us by name. He's going to put out his hand and he's going to wait for us to respond to him and say, "Teacher," right? And I think it's really interesting that that's the term that Mary goes to, right? Teacher, because she's placing herself in that moment when she discovers that Jesus is alive. She's placing herself at his feet as a student. She's saying, "In this moment of despair, what do you want me to do? You are my teacher. Teach me. Call me. Tell me where you want me to go." Guys, it's time to be awake, right? It's time for us to wake up as a people of God, put down the things that are numbing us, and come to life. I've mentioned this before, and I'll mention this again. There's a meme that's been going around that says this: the church is not empty. She's been deployed. This is our moment to be there in the world, whether that's digitally, whether that is by making phone calls or writing letters, whether that's by looking to our own spiritual health, taking time and reading the Bible every day, right? Really taking this time not to numb ourselves to the pain that we're experiencing and that other people are experiencing, but to wake up and be prepared for Jesus to reach out and call our name. And there, guys, there is reason to hope. There is reason to hope because Romans 8:28 says that God will make all things work together for the good of those who love him. That means this too, right? Even this, God will make work together for the good of those who love him. So let's grow in our love of God, because God makes big promises, but God stands by those big promises. I'd like to close with this. And I normally close us in prayer, but I'd like you to close your family in prayer And what I'd like you to do is turn to the letter to the Hebrews, chapter 10, verse 23. And as a family, I want you to just pray Hebrews chapter 10, verse 23, which says this: "Let us hold unwaveringly to the confession that gives us hope, for he who made the promise is trustworthy." And before you dive in and pray, what I'd like you to do is just talk about that verse, Hebrews 10, 23, and talk about what God is promising to you in your life. Maybe you don't know yet. Maybe your answer is that you haven't asked him, right? But just take some time to discuss Hebrews 10, 23, and then close with an Our Father as a family. I'll see you all next week.